With its 10th birthday rapidly approaching, Five Nights at Freddy's has proven its worth. With over 10 games, many books, a diehard fanbase, and even a movie, this franchise has passed the test of time with flying colors. This video will be divided into the multiple aspects of the FNAF franchise, talking in depth about each game, the books, the movie, and more. We'll start from square one. What is Five Nights at Freddy's? I won't spend too much time on this, assuming most of you already know, but Five Nights at Freddy's, abbreviated as FNAF, is a video game franchise containing 10 games, depending on which you count, many books, a movie, and an abundance of fan-made games. The first game in this series, simply titled Five Nights at Freddy's, is an indie horror game created by Scott Cawthon as a last-ditch effort to make a living off of game developing. He had many other works before FNAF, but none of them really stuck with fans as Five Nights at Freddy's did. This game was set up as a horror game, where you, playing as a security guard in a restaurant with four animatronics, are tasked with the objective of simply surviving from 12 to 6 a.m., the only problem being the animatronics, who desire to
forcefully stuff you inside a Freddy Fazbear suit
if you let them into your office. Over the following 10 years, many more games and books and movies have been released under the Five Nights at Freddy's name. YouTube single-handedly brought this franchise the exposure it deserves, and even I have YouTube to thank for finding this game. More specifically, Jacksepticeye and Markiplier, two of the most iconic Let's Players to ever exist. At the time, it was just another upload of theirs, but many of us didn't realize the magnitude of each video. It was insane, like nothing the internet had seen before. August 8th, 2014, Five Nights at Freddy's was released, and not a week later, Markiplier, who at the time had just under 3 million subscribers, uploaded his first video on the game.
Hello everybody, my name is Markiplier, and welcome to Five Nights at Freddy's, an indie horror game that you guys suggested and—
Oh, the sounds, I don't like them. Ah! No! Oh,
yeah! I tried to push it!
An action-packed, excitement-filled experience, catered towards a younger audience. This was the point in the game's stage where everyone was new to it, and we were all having fun. It was a success. YouTubers and viewers alike embraced the game and absolutely loved it. Also, you can hardly talk about the state of FNAF on YouTube without talking about all the theory videos that consequently hatched from the hype train. We also can't talk about FNAF theories without talking about MatPat. That man and his team have dedicated so much to FNAF. No number or statement can define the dedication Matt has shown toward the series. I can say for sure that Matt has had a huge influence on the games, and we all wouldn't have the perspective on FNAF without his enjoyable content. Also, that cameo in the movie was pretty funny.
Some people say that, but you know, it's just a theory.
Are you being paid by the word, or could we have a minute?
But in all seriousness, I'm so grateful for all the incredible work he has done in his career, and I think most other FNAF fans would agree. And on that note, let's talk about Scott. He's a good guy. The one thing better than a strong community is a strong relationship with the creator, and I can safely say that Scott has achieved that. He is a super effective hype builder, and it was always exciting to see the development of each game before it was released. He always took his fans on the journey with him, and that's what made him so important. I remember how dumbstruck we all were the numerous times Scott would hide something super obscure in his games. He always had insane attention to detail, and these days Scott has retired but is still very active in the community. He also recently put in motion the FNAFverse initiative, a project to embrace fan-made games and potentially wire them into the lore of FNAF. Next up, each game. The first game is many people's favorite, and understandably too. The perfect blend between horror and storytelling is really what the game is about. People really chewed through the story before it got too convoluted. My dad asked me on the drive home from watching the movie, why do I like Five Nights at Freddy's? And I can't say I was, or still am able to answer that.
Editor's note, I don't think I can say I don't know why I like FNAF. A little while ago, MatPat released a video reflecting on the impact of FNAF. He made many great points, so I would highly recommend checking that out. The main bullet points for why I like the game would probably just be because of the right combination of many things. The first game was so good at capturing the audience. It had an incredible atmosphere, intriguing lore, and so many good people playing it.
And most of all, we were kids. The target audience for lots of advertising is kids, as MatPat perfectly describes.
A healthy fandom lasts on average about 9 years. So if you become a fan of something at the age of 14, on average, you could be a fan of that thing until you're 23. This is exactly the huge and important time of your life that all social platforms and entertainment franchises want to tap into, because if they get you early, they get you for a huge bulk of your prime spending years.
But that's aside from the point. FNAF 1 truly encapsulated an incredible idea that stands the test of time very well. But the second game is where it's really at for some people. The more engaging and exciting gameplay is more suited for some, and it is a truly captivating experience. It's pretty much just FNAF 1, but cranked up to 11. Similar to the first game, you're a night guard, working from 12 to 6, keeping the animatronics at bay, but there are so many more mechanics to stay on top of. This game was really the true start of all the FNAF hype. It had every Let's Player playing, and by now the name really held value. At this point, people were raging over the story. Scott had mentioned that the game was a sequel to the first, but theorists determined it wasn't. The third game, though, that game is a bit harder to talk about. It never really gathered the retention that FNAF 2 had, and it wasn't as much of a hit for sure. I made a whole separate video on that topic, so go check it out if you're interested. It's most likely that the third game didn't take off as well because it was the same basic idea as the first two, and the fans were ready for a change. It wasn't a bad game, it just wasn't groundbreaking or special from the first two. I gotta give credit where it's due though, this game had incredible attention to detail. Like I said earlier, Scott has always had an eye for Easter eggs. This game had so many interesting secrets. The fourth game, however, is more loved by the FNAF community for numerous reasons. The jump scares were more intense and scary than the thirds.
Okay, so the first night is never usually that bad in any of the games, so I'll play through. What the f-
The lore was far more revealing and accessible, and it definitely held more big picture value than many of the other games. And unlike the first three, it changed what we knew about the standard FNAF gameplay. It was a different experience. You, playing as a child, defending yourself from nightmarish depictions of the original four animatronics in your house. Now, depending on if you count FNAF World as a game, it would be the fifth in the series. This game was an RPG-style game, mainly consisting of little battles and challenges here and there. I personally wouldn't count it, it sort of just feels like a game that Scott made for fun and for no particular story reasons. I never really cared about FNAF World, to be honest, but I don't blame the people who did. It's all personal preference. In my opinion, the real fifth game is Sister Location, which I loved. Sister Location had very unique gameplay. It was a point-and-click game consisting of a nightly routine of checking up on the animatronics and repairing different things around the facility. This game is truly one of my favorites, and it has some of the most replayability among the FNAF games. Sister Location also received DLC for Custom Night that held a bit of lore. Another example of Scott being Scott, before the release of FNAF Sister Location, Scott told fans that the upcoming game Sister Location was too mature for kids and he was releasing a beta version on Game Jolt, only for fans to realize that it was a complete joke. The real game was released the next day. And now, Pizzeria Simulator, the sixth game in the series. That game had so much lore, so much gameplay, and so many endings. It felt like a pleasant holiday release that was made for us to all feel the FNAF feelings over again. It was stressful, lore-packed, and entertaining, which is all we ever want from a Five Nights at Freddy's game. This game's idea was that you've been contracted to manage a Fazbear restaurant, and only later do we realize it's a death mission if done as intended. I personally didn't like this game as much, as it wasn't fun to play. It was a comparatively tedious experience, and wasn't as engaging as some of the other games. And 6 months later, we were blessed with another free FNAF game, Ultimate Custom Night, which was one game to conquer them all. It had every animatronic, except these guys. Scott, why? And your goal being, of course, to survive until 6 a.m. Each animatronic had a different mechanic, and I think this game was pretty good. It was surprisingly lore-filled and mechanic-packed for being a free game. It was also almost impossible to beat 50-20 mode, which was all 50 animatronics set to max difficulty, 20. And I say almost impossible because inevitably a few people managed to beat it. But less than a year later, Help Wanted VR was released. I vividly remember how fans and YouTubers reacted to that game.
Don't do it! Loaf! In Christ.
That game was very special, and it was so well done in my opinion, and it was very well received. Help Wanted also contained adequate lore and was overall a very fun experience. The gameplay was mostly just the older games, but remade for virtual reality and some new parts and service challenges. Help Wanted also received some DLC, The Curse of Dreadbear, which I thoroughly enjoyed. For Help Wanted, Scott Cawthon opted to hand over development to Steel Wool Studios, a partnership that continues to this day. The next game, Security Breach, released in 2021, is a bit sad in my opinion. This was the beginning of the next generation of FNAF fans. Everyone who enjoyed the first games as kids were now teens and probably didn't care about FNAF anymore, me being an exception. Security Breach was a great idea, just poorly executed, and because of the strain that Steel Wool Studios felt from eager fans, they released it earlier than it should have been, and it was riddled with bugs.
Freddy? 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 Calm down, bud!
Freddy, please! Oh my god, no! Not like this! Not like this! Please! Give me in! Freddy!
It could have been so great, I loved the idea, but it's so disappointing how such a stunning open world game was ruined by lack of time. This game was played from the perspective of Gregory, a little boy who has been trapped in the Mega Pizzaplex, a massive Fazbear mall with revamped versions of the original characters, along with this abomination. As of right now, the game is very playable and only sometimes anger-inducing. At this point, FNAF seems to have come to an inevitable close, but that could not be further from the truth. Enter the year 2023. Last year was insane for Five Nights at Freddy's. We were blessed with DLC for Security Breach, a movie, and to end the year with a bang, a sequel to the well-liked Help Wanted VR game. First, the DLC, released in July 2023. Ruin was released for Security Breach. You play as a girl named Cassie on a mission to find and save her friend Gregory, who says he's lost in the ruins of the Pizzaplex, only to find that she's been tricked by a new character, the Mimic. Next, the new Help Wanted game, released in December. This game incorporated aspects from sister location, Security Breach, and introduced some new concepts too. It's similar to the first Help Wanted, as you're still doing little challenges here and there, but there are so many lore implications to be had in this game. And now, the star of the show, Five Nights at Freddy's, the movie. This was one of the most anticipated projects in the FNAF-verse ever. Originally announced in April of 2015, the movie would have been produced by Warner Brothers, but due to many unexpected inhibitions, the idea was dropped. The movie that actually happened was a Blumhouse production, and it was wildly successful. I really enjoyed it. It was a little cheesy, no pun intended, but it was quite enjoyable. It's also worth noting that Scott Cawthon wrote the entire script for the movie. And that brings us to the next section. Scott Cawthon, if anything else, is a writer. He wrote a total of 28 different books. Some novels, some guides, and others are just stories told in the FNAF universe. It felt surreal at the end of the movie because you could tell how much Scott cares for his fans. The movie had so many people hyped about it. I would recommend checking out Floop Loops' channel for the latest movie news. Speaking of, there will be a second movie on the way. Filming will begin this spring. I personally can't wait, but I'm unsure of how everything will turn out, if people will view this as a cash grab, but I'm excited. Scott may have retired, but it's clear he isn't done. He is the creator of so many good memories, so many awesome moments, and most importantly, he brought millions together to share a passion. With the second movie in sight, it's clear that FNAF isn't over just yet, but I doubt it will be anytime soon considering the rock-solid foundation it has built over the past decade. Anyways, that's pretty much the entire history of FNAF, I guess. It's clear how impactful FNAF has been, for pop culture and fans alike. I also asked some friends and members of the Floop Loops Discord server what made FNAF memorable, and the overarching theme was the story, and I couldn't agree more. I am of the belief that the community and story is what FNAF fans are here for. Some people forget that despite in some cases the games themselves not retaining a very strong gameplay, that's not what FNAF is about. The franchise has such a strong legacy, and it shows. No other horror series has gained as much traction across the internet as FNAF. Most of the time when you mention FNAF today, people are painfully reminded of the horror memes. But I think that's what makes this game so great, is the balance. Five Nights at Freddy's is truly a profound series, full of tragic stories, but also balanced out with humor. It's popular for a reason. It has so much depth, such a community, and I am honored to be on the same timeline as FNAF. Thanks for watching.